Listening to an audio podcast from the Synthesizer Sympathizer. My name is Matt, and what you're hearing is a new Ben Folds 5 track called Do It Anyway. You can pre-order the record by pledging at www.pledgemusic.com/BenFolds5. I recently had the chance to talk to Ben Folds about the new Ben Folds 5 record, and the following is our interview. All right. Well, first thing I want to ask you is, how is your solo work affected, you know, the way you're writing your new album? And how do you think, you know, the other guys' time away from the band has affected their writing for the album as well?
Well, it was obvious when we started recording, it was obvious that the time apart had been a really good thing. That was the main thing. It was like, wow, this sounds really cool. It's really inspired. It's very open-minded. And a lot of stuff got a chance to wash away. And then, you know, a lot of time to really realize how much we should appreciate the chemistry that we have, because that's what records are made out of, you know?
Yeah, and, absolutely.
That's what people work so hard to try to manufacture. It's like, oh, these are great songs. Now we have to cook up some kind of vibe. Well, not with us. You just start playing and it's finished. So that's really, really to be appreciated. That's the main thing, you know. I every time I go into an album, I'm still me, but I'm me on a different day, and everyone evolves. So it's random. We're hitting 12 years later when I have certain kind of ideas. And we play a certain way together, but it's pretty damn solid. And this is the most inspired session we ever played.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, it's by far. It's like there was a sense of there was a lot of pressure before when we were in the studio, and there was a little bit of sense of dread about it all, and we were very, very tired. We were worked really hard. So when we were in the studio, we weren't able to kind of be appreciative about these things. We were just like, success on an album, success on a song would be relief. It wouldn't be something you'd celebrate. Something sounding good is like, well, that's what it does. It sounds good. Big fucking deal. Next. You know, it was a little like that. This time, stuff's coming out of the speakers. I'm thinking, man, should we tone that down? That's like so over the top and energetic. Maybe that's too much. And then I hear myself thinking that. I go, you're on crack. You don't do that. Like, this is, you can't pay for this kind of take. This is kick ass. So, we were really happy with it. We moved really, really quickly, and then we all had schedules to go to, so the record didn't get finished.
Is it about halfway done, or what do you think?
No, it's more than halfway. I write backwards. I always have. The point always comes last in my song. And I think that's a strength and a weakness at the same time, but that's just, you know, it's unique for me, and the point's always last. Like, I don't know, a song like popular song like The Luckiest, the very last thing happened to that song was me sitting around trying to figure out what that line would be. I am what? I am this? A fucking cheeseburger? What am I? I don't know what I am. And that, you know, the revelation that that's what it was, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning, same line, that was that. And that's kind of, you know, so that this album has 4 songs that need that.
Okay.
That's all. It's like 4 songs that I have to crown, but we've done them. I've got a vocal on them that has some words and gobbledygook, and you know, that's always the way we worked. Reinhold, the entire record was recorded. The guys never knew what any of the titles would be. It's like, this song is this in E flat, this one's in A,
Is this all of it's a product of you, you know, you said you write songs backwards, and I remember hearing you say that you think of the lyrics last.
Yeah.
So is that kind of the byproduct of it, is that you've got all these kind of instrumentals and you're thinking up ideas for them last?
Yeah, I mean, the melody is strictly implanted, but, you know, the melody was important. The cadence of the lyrics is not negotiable. Like, it's there. Like, I, you know, it's weird. I walk around with it in my head. And I go, oh, that's so sad. But I don't even know what the lyric is.
Okay.
It's just that I know that that's what it's doing there. And then it's like, that's two lines of description. I can feel that's description. What is it describing? I don't really know yet. And that's kind of where that's where I go. And then I have sometimes a process of going through and systematically, it's not a word, but unformalizing.
Okay.
You know, where if it's feeling roses red, violets are blue, I'll go back and I'll sing, how would I, what's the conversational way to do that that's natural? Because often it's not that it's natural, it's that it stumbles, it's awkward, you know, and that I like that. So I go back and I do that a little bit. At the end, sometimes when I feel like I've come up with something that's a little stilted and poetic, I don't want any poetry in my fucking song. I want it to be conversational and to let the melody be the poetry, so that if you spoke French, you'd still get it. At the same time, I think I get so picky about that I become a pretty good lyricist despite myself, you know, like because I can't fuck the music up. Like, I don't want to mess it up. So I put a lot of pressure on myself. That, you know, I've got four songs that are like, you know, they're three quarters of the way there. And if I wanted to do it the cheap and easy way, I would just simply fill in the lines that I need to, and I would just go and punch them in on the recorder and just be done. But I still, we got such a sense of event on the record that I think what I need to do is have them in hand, come back in the studio ready to sing them, and possibly even have the guys play along with it again live and just do it again to make it work. But we, you know, we're just, you know, we just got cut off. We had probably 5 days left in order to finish the record, and it was just a bummer. We had to leave. It's like, fuck. Now we're on a roll and we got to go. But we'll get it together in early June between two festivals. We have 5 days to get this shit together.
No, that sounds great. I know people are really excited. You guys have your first track out. And I wanted to ask you specifically, you've got a track in the Pledge video. What's that called?
It's called Sky High.
Yeah, that one sounds very old school, kind of Ben Folds 5. You know, like, I feel like I haven't heard that type of song from you in a little while. And it's, you know, it's really exciting. It sounds like a really cool song. Can you tell us a little bit about how that was made?
Yeah, that's Darren's song. Darren wrote that and came in with a very guitar-y, beautiful version of it. We started playing that and making it more and more us, you know. And I started feeling like the song had clouds floating by, even though it's called Sky High. I was like, when you're laying there and they're like, there's only one cloud and it floats by and it gets your attention, we need that in there, like this, just sort of these just like errant, fluffy clouds going by. And the way we decided to do it, the way I just heard doing it immediately, was using a trick where you loop. You musician at all?
Yeah, I am.
Okay. Singing Oz, unison, and looping each one of them across 2.5 octaves of the key of the song. The song was in E flat, so there was 2.5 octaves of Oz, meaning we're going to go next track, next track, and then pretty soon you're like and you're just moving up, right?
Yeah.
Then all these are looped for the entire length of the song and put back through the console and played as notes on the console.
Well, that sounds...
And that gave it an ethereal, you know, kind of clouds floating by. It's a trick that 10cc made popular in the 70s. We did it a little bit differently, but I think it's like a very crude sampler where you can't actually play the notes. You have to just sneak it up. And to me, like, that was, you know, that was vibey. And then Robert played upright bass. No, he gets the upright bass out every once in a while on a record. He did on Brick, and on the next record, a song called Hospital Song. He just, every once in a while, it calls for an upright bass. So it's got that tone.
Yeah, I mean, that sounds really exciting. I remember you had mentioned that a little bit in your blog. You've kind of increased your blogging capacity lately, and I kind of feel like we're seeing this humanitarian Ben Folds right now, where you're kind of reaching out to the fans and you're saying, you know, like, you wrote the one about, you know, if you want to make it in the music business, you know, the best you could do. What's inspiring this?
Well, I don't know. I guess it's just a lot of thinking of on my own, realizing that might be helpful for someone, wishing that someone had said some of those things to me. I spend more and more of my time doing things like advocating the arts. I'm on the the board of directors of the National Symphony Orchestra, and on the education committee there, and I don't miss a meeting. And I don't know, it's just, it feels good. I don't know, it just seems right. I think, you know, one of the most satisfying things about my career, when I look back on it, I go, what's really satisfying? Well, one thing that's been really satisfying has been the sort of collaborative nature of my career, like Not the Same, where everyone sings the Oz, that being spontaneous from the audience. That's pretty fucking cool. You know, Rock This Bitch, if people like, I mean, certain people are probably sick of it, but most people are pretty amazed that a new song happens immediately. Do It Anyway came from a guy yelling, Do It Anyway. We were at a show, and I said, I can't do this or this, and the guy goes, Do It Anyway! And then I just made up that song, or what most of what became the song. And then seeing people who are in my audience generation after generation grow into their own and do pretty well. You know, like, John Mayer, used to see him backstage, or he was selling bootlegs of my album. And, you know, now he's done really well.
Yeah, he has. You mentioned
Katy Perry, Kesha, Josh Groban. These people were fans of the music before they were doing it, and you think, wow, it's really cool to think that you can inspire people to do something like that, like they can achieve that. And what if I just took it one step further? And also, I know the music business is taking a big shit. I mean, it's dying. So I see, like, music therapy is something I like to get involved with and help out with. I think it's a really important trend, and I see a lot of creative possibilities in that. And it's luminous, it glows, and I move towards it. And that's just the kind of shit. I mean, it feels good to do that. And I find myself doing so much of it these days that I probably make about half the living that I did a year ago. But I'm totally happy with what I make anyway. And I can't help but think that it's good for you. So that's all.
Yeah.
That's a long-ass answer.
It's a good one. Yeah, you said that the industry has kind of changed, but at the same time, all this recording, you know, recording software is so much cheaper than it used to be. I mean, do you think that's, you know, that's a good thing, right?
Yeah, I mean, they're tools, you know, and you can get ideas down with the tools. I mean, it just is what it is. I don't know if I definitely don't put a it's good or it's bad on it.
Okay.
I don't see it as I don't know. It just is, you know. I think it's cool that you can record, and you know what we're missing. What the storm in the music industry is all these vacuums and the filling of the gap and the rush to try to figure out, you know, how to distribute music and how people are going to make a living and all that stuff. And it's just the same old thing, just a different, same shit, different methods, and there's no real filter. I think that's the main thing.
Okay.
We're still rushing to find a filter, and I think we may be getting somewhere at the moment, and it's a little alarming to me because I think what we're seeing is that mid-selling, mid-level artists may be the new music business.
Okay.
That's kind of what seems to be emerging. Artists who have incentive, like myself, to do things independently, will create channels for the next artist to come along. And so, for instance, Amanda Palmer, she's now established a very viable channel for getting music out.
Yeah, she's your buddy.
What's that?
I was just thinking of your video. You say she and Steve Jobs are the only people who know what they're doing.
Yeah, and now Steve's not with us anymore. But no, she's just created. I mean, a little bit, that's tongue in cheek. I'm just kind of being silly. But no, she is really creating something. Now her album. I know what her album budget was because I produced her last album. It was about, I think, about $80,000. She just raised at least $600,000 in 2 weeks on Kickstarter.
Oh, wow.
She's the new record label. Now, to the extent that the old system collapses due to these kinds of hits, because that was just a blow. I mean, that was a very symbolic blow to the music industry that they all know about. Now, when someone wants to get their song out, if Amanda likes it, she can put you down the same channel and you'll get some of those people, because they'll do anything Amanda says because they trust her. Because she spent years gaining their trust, and she's earned it. Blue Note Records used to be that. You know, like, you knew, who's this John Coltrane guy? I don't know, but he's going to be good, you know. This is Miles Davis guy on Columbia. He's going to be good because we know that Columbia Jazz is good. People thought like that. Now you don't know. Like, you know, it used to be like maybe Sub Pop, you know, had that for a little while.
Yeah.
But XL has a little bit now. Not as strong as Amanda does. Amanda has got it. She's got them all beat. But the thing is, and why I find it alarming is that she's going to have to take on that responsibility. And I love her music. I don't necessarily want to see her spending all her time being a record label, but I think that she's going to have to.
Sorry. Keep going.
And in a way, that's what I'm resisting a little bit. You know, we're doing this much more low-key than Amanda did it. I guess part of it is maybe my instinct that I'm not dead sure if I'm ready to be a record label. And Amanda would probably say, I don't know. I mean, she will certainly speak for herself. And I talked to her a couple days ago, but we didn't talk about business. I always talked about a bunch of crap. But, you know, she would probably say, one, she doesn't mind. And secondly, well, I don't know. I think she would have an angle that would be very intelligent about it. But I still kind of think that that's what's going to happen. She's going to see an artist that she likes. And so she can raise $600,000 for her own record. Or she can certainly raise $60,000 or $80,000 for someone else's, just like that. And then they have distribution. Their record's paid for before it even comes out. The record labels can't do that now.
Yeah, it's exciting.
It is exciting, but at the same time, it's, you know, history. It does not change the way people think it does. It's like, wow, this is the Bolshevik Revolution. Now we've got, oh, the Stalin guy's not too nice, is he? We kind of like the Tsar better. You know, it's not always what we think it is.
Yeah.
And I think Amanda's, I keep saying this, she's a responsible kind revolutionary. She's going to do good things, but she's not the only one. And there'll be a whole group of people who are mid-selling artists, and it'll be, they will have the power. And maybe, you know, like Frank Zappa used to always point out that the record business was better when it was run by people who didn't know anything about music. Mm-hmm. And that's when you had all the acts signed in the 60s, because these old men would just go, cigar-smoking dudes, and they'd just go, well, let's just see what Janis Joplin does. Fine. They just throw it up against the wall. Sells great. Does it. They didn't pretend to understand it. Then the next wave of business people came along who thought they knew. That's where the problem started. And so we don't know if this is going to be good or bad. We just don't know. But it's interesting. I think it is exciting. I'm just cautious about it because I feel like, you know, one, I'm a little sad to see the record labels and the kind of trouble that they are. I know that sounds weird. I raged against them for years, but they got their asses kicked enough. Uncle. And what, and you know, we need them. You know, like we need someone to do that. Someone has to do it.
Yeah.
I'm now being my own publicist today.
I gotcha.
So so there's still a publicist. You're still an interviewer.
That's right.
There's nothing changed.
Yeah, well, do you have time for one more question, or?
Yeah. Sorry, I'm talking so long about it. I'm doing very few of these. I'm just making sure I'm very thorough in them.
No, it's fine. I just don't want to, you know, take too much of your time.
Yeah.
Well, can you just give us any you know, any neat tidbits for the new record? I know that's what people want to hear about because it's kind of it's a big thing. It's been 12 or 13 years since you guys have recorded, or.
Yeah. Well. We released or leaked that song, Do It Anyway, because it was somehow, like any good diplomat, it sort of filled a lot of the bills, you know? But the record has a few pretty damn radical moments, and it's pretty, I think it's a pretty heavy record. I think it's actually a heavy record. It's fun, but there is a definite, it's a strong record. I don't think people really realize that the song Sky High on the Pledge video was like on the album. I'm not sure that registered to people. We should have put a little print underneath it that said Sky High off of the new record, you know.
Yeah.
Maybe if people want to hear more about what the record sounds like, go watch that video and listen to the song. It's clear. It's all on there. It's just rough. You can't really hear the background vocals all that well because we were, that was just one pass while the engineer was working on it. I just turned the phone on and started recording it. But people can hear where it's coming from. There's some, one song's got some absolutely insane harmonic shit going on. There's one song I wrote with Nick Hornby for this record. Darren has the song Sky High, which is a gorgeous song. I think it's a like really, it's going to be an important song on the record. There's a really beautiful waltz on the record. I think it's kind of like most of the songs will seem like, oh, I can see that. That's a Ben Folds 5 song. Yeah. But it's us now. You know, it was very, very us now. We did a lot of really jazzy playing that we steered away from a little bit for this record, but I think we'll probably come out should we do another one, because we've got enough ideas left over to make two more records, I think.
Wow, two more records after this one?
Yeah, we could easily make two more records, yeah. No problem.
Wow, well, that's really exciting. I know that people will be excited about that, because I know with you, you know, no one's ever sure what you're doing next.
Yeah, well, I can imagine, for instance, that we might make a 60s pop jazz sounding record, except it'll have distorted bass on it, for an EP.
Oh, wow.
We had these real Ramsey Lewis Christmas album sounding shit we were doing, and it was bitching. It was so cool. But it wasn't leading to the songs in the way that the songs were presenting themselves. Like, the record has a theme that seems to be recurring over and over again, which is the attempt of the loss of the ego.
Mm-hmm.
Probably kind of, probably fairly zen thing, actually, on some level. but yeah. It wasn't really intended to be. But it kind of has that you are in hell because you have a story. You know, basically, it's probably like fucking what's his name, the German dude, the self help guy. Can't remember his name. All the middle aged women love him.
I can't think of who you're talking about.
I shouldn't even mention his name now, because that wouldn't be a nice way to present it. But the record has that. Like, a lot of the songs have the stripping of the ego. There's one song about a total fiction, about Frank Sinatra's tour manager once Frank Sinatra died, because his tour manager in this song only lived to work for Frank, and then Frank was dead, and then he didn't know who he was, so he had a crisis, and then there's a lot of songs like that. There's a song called Erase Me. Well, that's obviously someone trying to erase themselves. It doesn't work. They just get bitter about it. So a lot of the songs, and Do It Anyway has a lot of, Do It Anyway is an honesty song, and that's just about releasing your control of your version of what happened. And accept what happened, you know. Accept that you do some great stuff and you do some really shitty, fucked up stuff, too. So, all the songs have that. So, a lot of this Ramsey Lewis style stuff that we were playing musically wasn't syncing up with the way the album was going. So, we just thought we'd chill and sit on it. But there's a lot of it.
Well, that all...
There you go.
Yeah, I'm there. Yeah, it all sounds... It all sounds fantastic.
Yeah, I think the records come out. Everyone has an opinion about it. You can't control that. I know that it's good, and it's really exciting for me to get it out. And I like the idea of not subjecting the record to the kind of commercial process that happens that makes you hate a record.
Mm-hmm.
This way we come out of it, we're still proud of it, and we know that the people, the reason I'm talking to you is I don't want the people who might want to know the records out to not be able to get it. And I'm not trying to convert anyone who doesn't know or doesn't want converting. We're not doing a missionary thing on this. We're not riding bicycles through Nicaragua trying to get people to like our record. We're just distributing it to those who like it, and that's going to take is a lot of this and a lot of you posting the pledge site and me retweeting your posts that people go to your, and just, it's a real kind of incestuous thing where we just have to recycle the same people through until they understand that there's a record out, and then we've done our job. Then we're going to move on to the next one. You know, it just needs to sell to the people who like it. If that's 10,000 people, awesome. We had something like 160,000 downloads over the weekend of Do It Anyway, so I think we know there are people out there that want it. But that doesn't mean they're going to buy it or even know it's out. A lot of people downloading it don't even know where it's from. They just listen to the song. No idea that the album's out. No idea where you can buy it. They just got it.
Yeah, well, you've got almost 500,000 Twitter followers and more than 500,000 Facebook likes. You know, someone's going to be buying it.
Well, yeah, but finding those people, it's actually, because I tweet something doesn't mean that many people saw it. It just means that many people could see it if they checked it, but they may not be checking it. And I'm finding out, like, even though I've been tweeting my ass off lately, I'm still getting people sending up tweets to go, what? How did I miss those new Ben Folds 5 record? Well, I don't know, because I said it over and over again, but this is the way it works, and so we're figuring that out. It's a good theory. Like, wow, dude's got 500,000 Twitter followers. He should be able to sell some records, but, you know, we're finding that turning that energy in the direction of, you know, getting the word out there is actually very difficult. So we'll keep doing it.
Right on. Well, Ben, thanks a lot for joining me today. It's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, no worries. Sorry that I was late. I went ahead and went extra time because I felt bad about being late. So
oh, no problem. Yeah, well, thank you, and I hope you've enjoyed our little conversation, and I look forward to hearing the new record in the fall. You can find it... You don't know the URL off the top of your head, do you?
For what?
For your pledge site. I guess you could just Google pledge music Ben Folds 5 or something.
Yeah, that's how you can. Yeah, that's how you'll want to do that. Just do. I think it's actually pledgemusic.com/BenFolds5 will get you there.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Ben.
No worries. Well, thank you. Good to talk to you, man.
Yeah, good to talk to you, too.
All right. Cheers.
See ya. My thanks to Ben Folds for joining me. Be on the lookout for the new Ben Folds 5 record coming this September. And make sure you head to pledgemusic.com/BenFolds5 to pre-order the new record.
Sometimes it's not subjective, wrong and right. Deep down you know it's downright wrong, but you're invincible tonight, so you do it anyway. It's done, you did it. Despite your grand attempts, the chips are set to fall, and all the stories you might weave cannot negotiate them all.